Hello and welcome everyone. This is a Screencast-O-Matic recording for the part of the lesson from Unit 3, Lesson 6. In this particular part of the lesson, we're going to be looking at some of the key events that comprise to form the Arab Spring for Egypt and the rest of the greater Arab world. Before I get started, please let me encourage you once again to open up to the correct part of the lesson and then, of course, provide a description in your own words of the events as they appear on the timeline chart. Please remember that you can replay any part of this presentation that you might need for detail or clarity later. Let's get started. From CNN. For a moment in 2011, it appeared that the revolution worked. Thousands upon thousands of demonstrators who had massed in Cairo's Tahrir Square succeeded in toppling a dictator who had ruled for nearly 30 years. But the euphoria faded as Egypt was whiplashed from one political extreme to another, from the oppressive government of the Muslim Brotherhood to the military regime that now rules. 5 years after Egypt's Arab Spring, the country is on shaky ground. Financially, unemployment is rampant and the people are angry, and an ISIS-linked insurgency is growing. The terror attacks becoming more brazen and frequent, nothing seems sure in Egypt today except that there's bound to be more fitful change ahead. Here's a review of what happened since 2011. January 2011, Arab Spring protests grip Egypt. Inspired by protests that ousted Tunisia's oppressive leader, tens of thousands of Egyptians gathered to demonstrate day and night for an end to President Hosni Mubarak's rule. Egyptian security forces battled back, and dozens of people died, but the protesters kept on, even more empowered. Tunisians and Egyptians started a wave of uprisings across the Middle East that called for peace, greater freedom, and better economic opportunity. Some rebellions worked. Tunisia is considered a mostly success story. Others, such as the uprising in Syria, led to widespread and continued bloodshed. February 2011, a longtime ruler leaves. In the face of protests, Mubarak said that he wouldn't run for re-election but vowed to finish his term in office. Eventually, he backed down against the overwhelming popular opposition and resigned. Deafening cheers erupted in Cairo. Egypt is free and God is great, protesters shouted. Throughout the year, the protests kept up as Egypt wrestled with change. In June of 2012, a longtime outsider gains power. Once a political prisoner who opposed Mubarak, Mohamed Morsi, became Egypt's first democratically elected president. A former member of the Muslim Brotherhood, Morsi gave a rousing speech calling for calm and progress. But tension between Morsi and the military remains despite his victory. In November of 2012, new president makes a power grab. Morsi issued an order preventing any court from overturning his decisions, allowing him to run the country unchecked. In that moment, he established himself as a true autocrat, analysts and critics said. Several thousand protesters subsequently turned out. Some called him Morsi the dictator. In December of 2012, protesters go after the president. Protests erupted surrounding allegations of mistreatment of anti-Morsi demonstrators outside the presidential palace gate in 2012. The turmoil convinced many Egyptians that Morsi was not just incompetent, but also violent. A Human Rights Watch report urged Egypt's public prosecutor to investigate the detention and abuse of several dozen anti-government protesters. A man shouts political slogans during a march to the presidential palace in Cairo in December of 2012. In July of 2013, protests turned deadly. Protests against Morsi raged. The president's opponents and his supporters clashed in Cairo University. At least 16 people were killed and 200 wounded, according to the state-run media. Morsi refused to bow to military leaders' ultimatum for him to find a solution to the violence or leave his post. A statement on the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces' official Facebook page said that we swear by God that we are ready to sacrifice our blood for Egypt and its people against any terrorist, extremist, or fool. The post was titled The Final Hours. Morsi refused to go. In July and August of 2013, carnage after Morsi's ouster. After a year in office, Morsi was ousted in a military coup. Roughly 1,000 Egyptians were killed during protests against the military government. In mid-August, Egypt's security forces used automatic weapons, armored personal carriers, and military bulldozers to raid and crush a Muslim sit in protests by thousands of Morsi supporters at Rabah al-Adawa, a mosque in eastern Cairo. Human Rights Watch investigated and found that at least 817 people were killed, calling the carnage one of the world's largest killings of demonstrators in a single day in recent history. In May of 2014, Egyptians suffer economically. The constant protests and political uprisings gave way to re-education and tourism, and an industry long considered significant economic lifeline to Egypt. The thing that demonstrators had asked for since 2011, a better economy, didn't materialize, experts said, and food prices and unemployment continued to rise. In June of 2014, a new president takes control. Egypt's former military chief, Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, became president, winning 96% of the vote. He vowed the nation would witness a total rise on both internal and external fronts. to compensate what we have missed and correct the mistakes of the past. Washington showed its support, but added caution. There was hope to advance our strategic partnership and the many interests shared by the United States and Egypt, the White House said, while noting the political turbulence with Morsi's exit. In November 2014, Mubarak's acquittal, then outrage. Mubarak, then 86, was cleared in a retrial after initially facing life in prison or worse after a Cairo judge dismissed charges linking him to the deaths of hundreds of Arab Spring protesters. The judge also found him not guilty of corruption, and protests then broke out. The prosecutor vowed to appeal the verdict, state media reported. April-June 2015, Morsi is sentenced. Morsi was sentenced to 20 years in prison after being convicted on charges related to violence outside the presidential palace in December of 2012. In a separate trial concerning a jailbreak, Morsi was sentenced to death. He and other Muslim Brotherhood leaders also received a license for espionage. In June to November of that year, ISIS affiliate strikes. An ISIS affiliate launched attacks on Egyptian military checkpoints. Soldiers and terrorists were killed as well as an Egyptian prosecutor. In August, an ISIS affiliate claimed that have beheaded a Croatian hostage kidnapped near Cairo. The Sinai Peninsula became a new front in the battle against ISIS, and the Egyptian wing of ISIS claimed it downed a Russian passenger motor jet flight 9268, killing all 224 people on board. In February of that year, terrorism tied to plane drowning. Egyptian leader Sisi publicly linked terrorism to the downing of the Russian plane. Reportedly, for the first time, it came months after Russian authorities said a bomb brought the aircraft down. And Western intelligence said a bomb was likely, but Egypt still hasn't issued a definitive report about what happened to the plane. April of that year, Egyptians incensed over islands. Once again, protests turned violent, this time over the proposed sale of two Red Sea islands to Saudi Arabia and the spiraling economic crisis. Riot police in Cairo hit demonstrators with tear gas and rubber bullets. The proposed islands sale came after Saudis invested billions in Egypt. The islands, which are between the countries, are strategically important for transport points of ships headed to Jordan and Israel. Also, a bridge over the Red Sea that Sisi and Saudi King Salman want to build remains wildly controversial. According to Sisi, the bridge would support export between the countries, but many Egyptians said they fear it would make their country a colony of sorts of Saudi Arabia. So there you guys have it. A few events that comprised a former understanding of the Arab Spring as it relates to Egypt. One final point I want to leave you with here is something to consider. Although many people today place a lot of emphasis and praise on revolution, in that these are people who are trying to make their country better by overthrowing dictators, one thing we have to ask is how better are their lives after the fact? When power vacuums are evident, people come in. Just because people might be democratic or people might embrace popular sovereignty, does that necessarily mean that good people are being put in place of those governments to rule and exist and persist? That's something that only time will tell. Thank you very much for tuning in, and good luck completing the rest of the lesson.